Hello everyone, this is Deron Land, host of TFYLP. We're not going to have a live episode this week because we have lost one of our own. Chad Williams passed away this past Monday, October 31st, 2016. He was a very dear friend of mine and a valued member of this cast. He wasn't always on the show, on screen. He popped in from time to time, but he was very instrumental behind the scenes in helping me formulate ideas, and I have him a lot to thank for the format of this show that makes us a little bit different than a lot of other shows out there. You know, we do things a little bit differently here, and we have a lot of that to thank Chad for. There's many other things we have to thank Chad for. Too many really to list here. Chad was a good man, survived by his wife Kristen and his sons Miles and Camden. He was the founder of the convention known as Slagicon that lasted 4 years. I was happy to attend 3 out of the 4. I was unable to attend the first one due to work commitments. But I met Chad for the very first time at my first Slagicon. Didn't get to talk to him much then. But it was actually through this show. We had him on as a guest, and he and I got to talking and really hit it off as friends. He and I had a lot in common. Not only did we share a passion in collecting Transformers and have a lot of the same likes and dislikes within the fandom, he and I also shared the same profession. It's really difficult for me to formulate my words this evening, and I apologize for me rambling like this and being so random, but I'm very candid right now. Most likely by the time everyone sees this video, his funeral will have come and gone. I do want to point people to the Kickstarter. I'm sorry, not the Kickstarter, but the GoFundMe page that he started about a year ago whenever he found out that he had cancer. Still needs quite a bit of funds for it. I know that even though he's passed, and insurance takes care of a lot of things, but sometimes it doesn't go as far as we would like it to. So I just want to help make sure that Kristen and the boys are taken care of as much as possible. So I think it would be very beneficial if you feel compelled, just $1, $5, whatever you can spare. The links can be found on tftalk.net. And our Facebook groups, the TFYLP Twitter account. You can follow us on there, and it will be on there. This episode of TFYLP will be a look back on Chad and some reflection upon him. Going to show a little bit from the first episode that he was ever on, and a few other videos. I believe there's going to be some videos added in here from the various SlagaCons that took place. And I want to thank our own Jim Black for providing some of these videos for me to add in. Those of you who didn't know Chad, just know that he was a good man. He was one of us. He was a very passionate fan of Transformers. He loved Generation 1. He loved Jazz and Ironhide. He loved Beast Wars, Rhinox, Rat Trap. He loved those. He loved Rhinox so much, he had a pickup truck he called Rhinox. I spent many hours talking to him through the nights. He and I worked the same shift for a few years. So there were many times that I would actually talk to him from the time I got to work. And this was on the phone, of course, but the time I got to work till the time I got home, and sometimes thereafter. We both would make sure that we would each stay awake and alert at our jobs and make it home safely. And there's a few times I'd say he probably saved my life, and I'm sure I saved his a few times too. I believe I was the first one that he called when he found out he had cancer. He was like a brother to me. He will be missed. Enough talk. Let's celebrate Chad and remember him for the good man that he was. Always putting others first before himself. And that was his whole goal behind SlagCon. He told me many times he didn't care how much money he lost, just as long as people had fun. And believe me, he did lose quite a bit of money because of what happened. And I know that he was sorry for what happened. He would have gave anything to let everybody know that he let down, that feel that he let them down, how sorry he was. I don't know if I should say it or not, but there was a time that I listened to him weep for several minutes on the phone because of what happened at SlagaCon, the second SlagaCon. And he spent the next two SlagaCons trying to make that right, and it didn't happen. And he still continued, even after SlagaCon was over, much to his detriment. I don't know if everything was ever fully taken care of. That was none of my business. I really didn't ask him about it all that much, except for what he volunteered to me. But I do know that he only had people's best interests at heart. He was a selfless man and always a positive man. He taught me how to be positive. He showed me how to be positive in the face of adversity. It's probably the number one thing that I'll remember Chad for. Also, in memory of him, our logo of this podcast will change forever. There will be a little CW added to our logo. If I haven't done it already, by the time this airs, and that will be to remember him. But without further ado, let's move on to memories of Chad. And I thank you all for tuning in for this very special episode of TFYLP.
You know, as a young kid growing up in Japan, every weekday after school, I was glued to the TV watching my favorite cartoon. Take a look. I remember. So now there's five ships there, right? They all come together and form one huge robot. It's called Voltus 5. Well, big kids like me have somewhere to go this weekend. SlagCon is a toy and comic convention planned for this weekend. The convention's founder joins me this morning. I assume this convention brings back a lot of memories for a lot of people, correct?
Yes, sir, it sure does.
How did you come up with the idea for this?
About 13 years ago, I decided to have a show, and I didn't have the money until a few years ago to actually fund it. So this is our fourth year, and now it's full blown, and we have a lot of guests coming and actors and whatever.
I'll tell you what, our senior producer was kind of geeking out over there, embarrassed by it, because you have the original Megatron here, don't you?
I have the original Optimus Prime.
Optimus Prime, right here. It's still in its box.
Yes, sir. Sure
how did is. You look, how, as a kid, how do you, did you get this as an adult, or did you get this as a kid?
This is not mine, it's Mega Toy Fans. It's actually a company that'll be out selling toys. That's from his personal collection.
Wow, okay.
He lent it to us in order to...
To show what you're doing this weekend.
To show what we're doing
this weekend. What are some of the other things you brought with you here today?
Well, we brought a G1 Scorponok. It has a head that is actually removable. But I'm not going to take that time.
Okay.
We brought some Universe stuff and, more popular, the Movieverse.
Version of the Transformers. Because the Transformers cartoon and the Transformer movies are two totally different things, correct?
Completely different. And then we brought some Star Wars stuff because on Sunday we have, it shifts away from Transformers and it's more just everything.
Well, tell me about, I know we have the cartoon of the Transformers in the control room.
Uh-huh.
Tell me about some of the voice actors you have coming on.
We have a gentleman named Buster Jones.
Uh-huh.
He voiced Blaster, but he also voiced Winston Zeddemore on Ghostbusters.
Okay.
And voiced some G.I. Joe voices in Hanna-Barbera. So.
Well, and usually that, because since you don't see their faces, they can be used for multiple characters, correct?
Yes, sir, and they're very good. And then we have a lady named Marlene Bannis, and she only voiced one character, four Transformers. So,
really?
Yeah.
But she picked probably the right cartoon to be a part of, correct?
Yeah, this is one of the biggest, longest-standing franchises in history.
I think it's going to be awesome. I'm going to put some information up on your screen. If you're interested in attending the convention, which celebrates everything toys, comics, movies, you can go to the Hilton Cincinnati Airport. That's on Turfway Road in Florence. It's from Saturday from 9 until 9, and then Sunday from 9 until 4:30. People who've been the last 3 years, what can they expect that's new this year?
Voice actors are different. The split in the 2 days is different. We've never had a separate, something celebrating other stuff
Absolutely.
Than Transformers. We have a costume contest this year for the first time, and we give out cash prizes and all kinds.
There you go. Check it out at the Hilton Airport Hilton.
Yes, sir.
Chad, all the best to you, man.
Thank you, sir.
Nice job. We have much more straight ahead on the Fox 19 Morning News. You may not know this, but October is National Pizza Month. Coming up, we're going to be kind of combining. Yeah, it is, Frank. We're going to be combining pizza and Halloween. We'll show you how next.
So I met Chad in 2010 in the first SlagCon. I went there as a dealer and had a great time. A little show way out in a little part of town in a little gymnasium. It was kind of funny to begin with, but it was great. It was neat. It was actually neat to see the voice actors and get to know them and talk to them one-on-one. Something you can't do in one of the bigger conventions. The small conventions like that were just, they're special in so many ways. I can't even describe it. I went to every one of them, all of the SlagCons, and had fun at each one, have experiences and memories from each one. But Chad was a unique individual. Had some problems, and he stood up to him. He faced him. He never backed down. He always did what he thought was best, and even though he didn't make the money that he wanted to, he actually lost money, he didn't care. He still trudged forward, and because he wanted to put on a show for the fans. He wanted something specifically for the fans, and he gave up a lot. He sacrificed a lot. I'm sure his family will attest to that. But mainly I just wanted to say that the community is truly losing a great member of the fandom, someone who really cared, and he's going to be missed. And I just wanted to say that Chad, I appreciated all you did, and I'm going to miss you.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to Transformers for Your Listening Pleasure, episode number 66. I am Weird Wolf. Along with me is Cyburn 2.
What's up, everybody?
On the phone, we have Insane Galvatron.
Hello, everybody. I'm in my car again. This should be fun. I'm actually getting ready to do another Transformer hunt in a Walmart.
Sweet. Second one ever. But if he cuts out, that's why. And also joining us this week is the organizer behind Slagacon, Chad Williams, or Trans Jazz, however you want to call him.
Hey, guys.
Hey, Chad. Welcome to the show. Glad to have you on here.
Thanks.
I want to remind our listeners that we are live right now on YouTube, October the 18th, 2013. If you are listening to us live, you can join in and comment on the comment section, and we can interact with you that way. If you have any questions or comments on the show, feel free to enter them in. Or if you have Twitter and it's more convenient, you can tweet us at TFYLP. And I'm also monitoring that. So if you have any questions or comments regarding Slagacon, while we have Chad on the show, we would love to hear from you. And I'm sure he would love to answer your questions regarding the show. Chad, tell us a little bit about Slagacon if you want.
Well, this is our fourth year, and we've moved it from the gymnasium at the little school that it used to be a school. It's called Mill Creek Civic Center now. We spent 3 years there, and they were three good years. You know, we've had pretty good guests, and we had a pretty good turnout the first 2 years, and then last year was a little rough, but that's okay. And then, you know, we've moved to Cincinnati, and we're putting it in a hotel. We have completely filled up the dealer's room to the point where we barely have room for people to walk. We have 5.5-foot aisles on each side, and we have two pathways in between those aisles, and every space in between there is completely filled with booths or tables. So it's going to be 4,000 foot of fun, of packed fun. Saturday and Sunday, October 26th and 27th. We're going to have Buster Jones, who I talked to today on the phone, and Arlene Bannis. I talked to her as well. They're very excited to meet everybody and see everyone. And, of course, on Sunday, we're going to have Daniel Ross and John Bailey Crumpton, John 3.0 for the fandom that knows him that way. And they're going to do, like, more of a sci-fi horror kind of, more of a Daniel Ross-esque movies kind of a thing on Sunday for us. So
sweet.
But other than that, man, you know, shows next week. Hope everybody comes out.
Definitely. It's, well, 1 week from tonight is dealer setup, so.
Yes, sir.
I don't know if I will actually be there that night. It'll probably be sometime in the morning. I'm actually trying to lock up a sleeping arrangement here. That way I can at least take my sleeping bag or something other and sleep on the floor. That way I don't have to commute back to Louisville, the Louisville area, even though it's only about an hour and a half away. But I'd rather not drive, spend 3 hours on the road, going to and from. But I'll definitely be there and going to have my little setup and stuff. I was hoping to get a banner made or something other for the table, but with our logo and stuff on it, but I don't know if I'll be able to do that because car insurance was due today and I didn't know that it was going to be available or come through today.
Your buddy's going to be there. Captured Prey?
Yeah, Captured Prey's going to be there. Mega Toy Fan's going to be there. It's going to be a really good show. I'm really looking forward to it. You said the pre-registration numbers are up and everything from previous years. Actually, I believe you said it's better than it was even the first year, correct?
Yes, sir. It's up, and I'm not going to say the numbers. I don't want to jinx myself. I always keep the numbers to myself. But yes, by about 30 or 40 pre-registrants, we are up that far.
Oh, wow. So that's really awesome. But in addition to later on in the show, for you Beast Wars or Beast Lovers, that didn't sound right. If you're into bestiality, Sideburn 2 is your man. We're going to be talking about the Beast series, Beast Wars, Beast Machines, and the Japanese Beast lines. A little bit later in the show, so stay tuned for that. Be talking about SlagaCon off and on, kind of going over some things, and Chad will be telling us a little bit more about that, and we look forward to his input. And I guess Insane Galvatron will join us whenever he feels froggy and his phone is cooperating. But I guess we'll kind of go into the Ouch My Wallet and a little bit and do that, and then we'll come back to Chad and talk to him some more about SlagaCon. Before we go into Ouch My Wallet. Ouch My Wallet is always brought to you by CapturedPrey.com. Great toys, great prices, great service. CapturedPrey.com. Ouch My Wallet. Michael, you got anything for us on Ouch My Wallet this week?
I do.
Sweet.
It's very small. Well,
that's what she said.
So I went to a Target today. I went to several places today. Target was brimming with brimming with tons of stuff that I wish I could buy, but I had no money for. But I found a Wave 3 Creos, and I didn't know which numbers were to what, so I just grabbed a bag, and I got Huffer.
Nice.
Sweet.
Unfortunately, Huffer was like the one I wanted least from the set. I was hoping to maybe get like the Insecticon or like Kickback or Cheetor or the Sharkticon. But I got Huffer. I like him. His truck mode is, pretty good. It still makes me wonder why we haven't gotten like an Optimus in the Creo line yet, or the Creo
line. Haven't seen the truck mode of it.
I'll throw it together here in a second.
I believe the new custom figures, he has a truck mode.
Does he? I didn't think those micro changed. I think those were just...
I've seen them today.
Oh, yeah? So, if they micro change, I'm interested. Other than that. Unless they micro change, I ain't too interested. I like him. I think he looks a little too... ready to rumble than I remember. Isn't Hufford like the coward type character? I can't remember.
No, he's actually a whiner.
Oh, yeah, he's so not cowardly, but whiny.
Yeah,
it was something like that. This looks like he's ready to beat someone up. He's got like a grimace on his face and two pistols, and he's ready to do some damage. But it works, and he adds to my very small Autobot army of Kreons. And I did get, well, I didn't get something myself today, but some starting the Christmas shopping, and we went to a Ross and found first edition Bumblebee.
Ooh.
And so I'm getting that for Christmas.
You already know a Christmas present 2 weeks, 2 months after.
I have known my Christmas presents, everything I was getting for Christmas since I was.
Hey, Mike, don't feel 16. Bad. I'm guilty of that, and my wallet is sitting right here beside me, and I think I told you what it's going to be during at some point earlier this week. So I know my Christmas gift already too, and it's sitting right here. I'm about to show it to you guys.
Yeah, I think because it's always been like since I was, you know, young, I've always been sent to the store with my mother, because you really don't want to go, you know, women don't really want to go to the store alone in Orlando.
Yeah.
So I've pretty much always known what I was getting for Christmas since I was like 15. My mom was always like, but it's not going to be any fun. I'm like, yeah, it will. Like, every day it's like, I can't wait until I get to open it. And so.
Well, it does alleviate that thing, that wonder of, am I going to get a crappy gift? Although, really, there's no crappy gifts because only good gifts.
But so, yeah, that'll be more on that in December.
Yeah. Oh, there's Insane Galvatron. He came back.
I hung up while I was going through the checkout. Sorry.
Oh.
Insane Galvatron's ouch my wallet is Rick Rissnapper.
Yeah.
Pacific Rim on the Blu-ray just bought it too.
Insane Galvatron's ouch my wallet is brought to you by Walmart.
He's breaking so many barriers.
Yeah.
We got live toy hunting and now live ouch my wallet.
Yeah.
There you go.
His wallet just sent out for $6.
Well, it was actually 27 if you count the Blu-ray disc. It was actually on sale for only $20. So the shelf tax at 25, but it rang up 20.
Ah. Well, that's not bad. They're probably comping the price.
Well, it's usually like the first week a DVD comes out, it's cheaper. For the first, like, it comes out on Tuesday and then up through Friday, and then like Saturday it goes up.
Yeah, I kind of looked out. My mother-in-law was in town the day that came out, so or the day before it came out, she kind of slipped me some cash for it. And I'm like, yay! But sorry, I'm getting rather distracted here again. Got so much going on here. My video is kind of, I don't know what's up with my video tonight. Is my video clear to you guys, or
it freezes every once in a while on my end?
Yeah, it's kind of like flickering on my side, and it's really distracting. I apologize to you listeners if I sound distracted. But Chad, you want to tell us about your Ouch My Wallet this week?
Yeah, it's this little guy. My wife got me this little guy right here.
Yeah.
But he came with a big guy. 2 foot tall thing? Yeah.
Yeah, he came with this guy. And this is my birthday / Christmas gift.
Oh.
So, that's my ouch my wallet. Other than me paying for the show so far, yeah.
Well, that's a good ouch my wallet, though.
Yeah, I like it. And my wife bought it for me, so I love it. So she's a great wife. She's completely involved with the show too. So that's awesome.
Yeah, I've gotten one Transformer from my wife, and unfortunately it's a Transformers Prime toy, and I'm pretty much selling all my Transformers Prime stuff, except for a couple figures, and that's one of the ones that I'm going to keep because I'm not going to sell something she gave me as a gift. So it was whenever I was still driving a truck, and I came home from the road one afternoon. I was dog tired, and I wanted to come downstairs and watch some TV and unwind, and there was a Transformers Prime cup sitting in my easy chair, and I'm like, I love you.
I found him today for $6.99.
Did you find it at TJ Maxx or Marshall's? Because they were on sale there dirt cheap at one point.
Dude, that was back in like March, so I don't remember.
That was when he was new.
Yeah, he was new then.
I found him at Big Lots.
Matter of fact, I don't think I'd ever even seen him on the shelf at that point. I come home and I'm like, wow, you found one.
Here's Huffer and his...
That's actually not bad. Although it kind of looks like a Lego step in his tab there.
He's I like that it uses the guns as smokestacks instead of those crappy smokestacks that they've used on other figures.
Is it just? It looks more like the GoBot.
it looks like stacks. Yeah.
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 So I'm surprised they didn't call it.
Are we still doing after my wallet? Because I have more than just Ripper Snapper.
We are. That's all I got. I just finished up and.
Okay. I'm not trying to jump in. Just whenever it's my turn, let me know.
Oh, we were just going to pass you over.
Oh, okay.
We were just joking because you came back.
Yeah, we're just going to be rude and not pay any attention.
Well, we were going to spoil the surprise.
All I got. Well, I didn't think you were going to skip me. I just figured you may have thought the Ripper Snapper and Pacific Rim were all I got.
No, we just wanted to spoil the surprise. Because it just happened. So we took your thunder away.
So the Metroplex is all you got there, Chad?
And
I'm using all you got, you know.
Well, I showed you some stuff earlier. I guess I could show you that if you wanted to see that right now. But we can wait if you want.
Yeah, let's wait for that because we're going to talk more about some of the
I'm hoping I can get my money soon, and I'm hoping to have enough left over after paying Greg for the jackpot and Ultra Mammoth, and I need to get, you know, Grand Theft Auto 5. That's a need, yes. It's a need. But I'm hoping...
Well, since I am a guest, I guess, for now, I guess I can show you what I got 3 weeks ago, and I got them all at once.
Hemorrhoids.
Oh, wait a minute.
Hemorrhoids.
But Orion Pax.
Oh, I like that guy.
Yeah, I want to
get
him.
And then Megatron.
Yeah, I really like that guy too.
The little thin thing that he is.
I think they pulled off his play mode really well.
They did. Trailbreaker.
Yeah.
Trail Cutter. And then Moist.
Moist.
Yep. I've got one other one, but he's sitting over on my shelf, and it's the Thundercracker, the IDW Thundercracker.
No, that's wrong. It's Fall of Cybertron Thundercracker.
Well, that's why he's sitting on my Fall of Cybertron shelf. I'll tell you what, I will pan over, and I will show you my Fall of Cybertron plus my little bit of Slagicon stuff. I don't know. You can see up there the third-party Omega Supreme.
Oh, Max Genesis. So cool. I love that thing, yeah.
There's some customs up there. There's the Slagicon custom, can't remember his name, from last year. And then I've got another one. Up there that doesn't have a head. What's that?
Yeah, custom figure last year with Terracon Cliffjumper.
No, there was two of them. It was Terracon Cliffjumper and Prowl.
Okay, I don't remember Prowl.
Cybertron Prowl. What's that?
I missed the Prowl. I didn't get to see that one.
I'll show it to you.
I thought Cliff Jumper was all there was.
Nope. 2 days, man. Two customs. But there's...
Okay, it's based on jazz. Okay.
Oh, that's cool.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, with the little lights and everything. So... But I've got every Fall of Cybertron figure there is, so...
I wish I did.
Yeah, I didn't pan down to the third shelf. That's all the Slagicon stuff. And there's a grim reminder of bad days past sitting there, so... The third shelf down, I didn't pan down to.
Oh, yeah.
Try not to.
Is it VZ?
Yeah, it'd be him. I can show it to you.
Yeah, I don't think a lot of viewers might not have seen one of those, actually.
Well, let me... I can't really pick it up because of where it's sitting. But let me see if I can... Can you see? Well, let me see if I can pick it up. Hold on. Talk amongst yourselves. I'm going to turn off my camera for a second.
Well, while he's doing that, I can do my out of my wallet. It won't take
okay. long. Okay. Go ahead, Greg.
I don't know if you remember the last podcast I was talking about that Ruination I got for $50.
Yes.
And then I was going to return the G2 Grammaticons in the packaging. Well, I also had a bunch of the newer Ninja Turtles that I had never opened. But I decided, you know what, I really don't want all these anymore. So I returned all that stuff to Walmart and got a bunch of store credit.
Which ones of the newer Ninja Turtles did you give up?
Well, I kept the turtles themselves. It was all the other figures, like Splinter and Shredder and the Krang and Foot Soldiers. The only thing I kept were the four turtles and Metalhead.
Oh, that's the four I have. Five.
The five. So I took that store credit from returning all that stuff, and I got Generations Trail Cutter. And also picked up the Marvel Legends Iron Man 3 6-inch figures of the Iron Patriot and the Mark 42. So I got my Iron Man 6-inches complete, except for the Mark 7 they've never released. And then I picked up a couple more Ninja Turtles. They had the Turtles in Training 2-packs. One had Leonardo and Donatello. The other has Michelangelo and Raphael. I picked those up kind of earlier in the podcast. I think we were broadcasting then. I was showing them on camera. It may have been before we went live. I picked those up. But they shouldn't be called Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles because they're like as little kids. They're like toddler Mutant Ninja Turtles.
Pre-teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles.
Yeah,
pre-teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles.
So those are really cool. I didn't even know those existed. Didn't know they were coming. I haven't really been following that line. I was just walking through the aisle and looked and like, oh, cool. And I grabbed them.
The only new figure that I've seen recently that I would remotely want to get would be Leatherhead. I've seen him a number of times here recently, and he looks really cool. But since I've already got the four turtles and Metalhead, I really don't want any more. So I've just picked it up, went up, and put it back. But he does look really cool. But.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but that's all I got this week. Wasn't a big haul.
That's what she said.
I did get more movies for most of the money when I bought a couple more Blu-rays, but that's... That's not this podcast. It is my movies. So.
Debbie Does Dallas and.
No, it was Iron Man 3 and Star Trek Into Darkness.
I need to get all those
both
movies.
Good movies.
Yes, both very good movies. All right, Chad, did you get? Let's see.
Yeah, here's. I've got him. Let me.
That looks really cool.
But there's all. There's the whole thing. Oops.
Now, very quick, nice. Transforming.
No. He, I will say this. In robot mode, he's awesome. In truck mode, he is a very nice paperweight. Not very movable. The trailer is a very nice paperweight. It don't have any moving parts. The guy did not do what he promised. Well, that's obvious.
Yeah.
But there was 9 of those total. And that's one of them.
And they were supposed to have been, what, 100?
100. Yep. So I've got one. And I know where most of the other ones are. There's one that was sold on eBay. Sold for like $250 or something. Sold pretty high. To some guy in Australia. So I don't know where it is, but I know where all the other ones are.
Well, you know what country it's in.
Yeah.
It's down under.
It's down it's under. It's either on the East Coast or the West Coast.
That's what she keeps telling me to do.
Go down under.
Go down under.
While we're kind of on that subject and everything, I want to give you an opportunity, since you're here on the show, to talk about that. But let me wrap up the Ouch My Wallet real quick and remind everyone that Ouch My Wallet has been brought to you by CapturedPrey.com. Great toys, great prices, great service. CapturedPrey.com for all your import transformers needs. Excellent prices.
Gosh,
great service. Yes, gosh dang it. Chad, as you were talking about the Vector Zeta fiasco, I guess. I know we talked about it on the podcast a few weeks ago, but there might be some listeners out there that wasn't familiar with it. If you want to kind of briefly go over what happened and what's going on to correct the issue.
Well,
kind of air it all out.
I won't mention any names because I've really taken the high road with this as much as I could. This guy that I had paid to make these Vector Zetas that I showed just a few minutes ago, he came to the show. I will say he's gutsy since he came to the show with nothing but a prototype.
I even talked to him, too.
Yeah. And he just ended up flaking out, you know, and which is really, it's really a sad deal because he was, and I didn't know this when I got involved with him, but he was an aspiring customizer. Garage kit customizer, not a
established
one. And that's, you know, I guess I should have done my research really well, and that is on me. I take full credit for that or whatever I need to take. But in any case, there was $22,000 or something, $25,000 of these things sold, because there was 100 of them at $250 a piece or $175 plus shipping. But it came out to like $22,000. I paid a lot of them back right off the bat because I had a pretty good stash of money still. And then I have slowly paid back I don't know, quite a few of them, and we're down below 30. I do know we're down below 30. I've got the list of people, and it's been very tough. I went through a very stressed financial situation last year, which I had never talked about, which is why the show wasn't as good last year. I blame myself because I didn't do what I needed to do to make it good, and I got flack from the year prior. But I have paid everybody back or, you know, all the people back that I have paid, you know, I'm actually paying extra because I have to pay the fees from PayPal also. So I'm actually paying back more than I actually have, you know, taken in. So hopefully this year, if the show's really good, and it doesn't have to be really good, but it has to be pretty substantial, we will have enough money to pay the rest of the people off, everybody. So at the end of this year, I look to be completely out from underneath this, completely out from underneath this big paperweight that I've got right here. So
he's a stress weight.
Yeah, you know what? The nice thing is he's a masseuse too. You can't really see it, but his feet work really well on your back. So, I just let him walk across my back whenever I need it. Because he weighs about, I don't know, the thing weighs a ton. But, so I've really worked at trying to get people taken care of and what have you. And, you know, I'm looking to make everything better. That's why we've moved the show. That's why we're doing what we're doing. We're trying to get everybody paid back. And we had planned on doing it last year, but Weird Wolf and Insane Galvatron were at last year's show. I mean, we could have thrown rocks at everybody and still had plenty of rocks left over. You know, it was pretty bad last year.
Well, I mean, I admit, you know, from my attendance of it, I was at the second show, which is the year that Vector Zeta was there, and I actually, like I mentioned earlier, I actually spoke to the guy that was doing Vector Zeta, and I didn't say much then because I really didn't chalk it up to anything, but I kind of felt, I got a bad vibe from him. You know, I mean, he wasn't really enthusiastic about it. You know, he just kind of there, and I picked it up, and he asked me what I thought of it, and I said, well, it looks really cool, but it's a proto, where's the real thing? You know, I mean, I wasn't able to get one. I actually had considered pre-ordering one, but I, you know, had decided late to come to the show. So
glad you didn't.
So I didn't actually pre-order one, but I told him, I said, well, I'm, you know, it's cool, but I didn't get in under the thing, but I was like, you know, I kind of wanted to see a real thing, and I hadn't seen anybody carrying any around at that time. At that moment, I wasn't really aware that he hadn't really followed through on things. And then there were some mumblings from some people that were going around the show. It's like, yeah, the dude, I was one of them that got it, and the dude didn't bring it. He didn't bring them. And I did hear some rumbling from some of the attendees about you personally, Chad. I mean, they said, you know, that you ripped them off. But, you know, in the end, if you look at the logistics of it, it wasn't you. I mean, you had in good faith given this guy money to do these customs for you, and he's the one that failed.
Right.
Yesterday, hold on.
Quit looking at porn.
I got a text message. I was
very unprofessional. Wait for you. Somebody else is talking.
I'm sorry. It was from one of our podcasters. I needed to look at it. Last year's convention, you know, I didn't let the bad press from the previous SlaggerCon actually deter me. And when Insane Galvatron said, "Hey, had you thought about going to SlaggerCon?" I'm like, "Yeah, I'm all for it." And I was honest. I was actually expecting a similar show last year. And whenever we got there, the parking lot was like three quarters of the way empty, and it added a little worry as far as the you know, how the show would go, but I'm going to be honest, and I'm not saying this just because you're sitting right here, Chad. I had a great time, even though the, you know, the attendance was small. I mean, Scott McNeil was there, and he is hilarious. You know how he is. John 3.0, I never really had a chance to hear him much and or know anything about him. And him and Scott McNeil, their panel went for like 2 hours, and I was entertained the entire time. And
we had to cut it, actually, because they had to go to the restroom.
Yeah. Well, actually, I think there was a couple people that were in the audience. They had to go to. I have to admit, I got up about 20 minutes before they wrapped because I was sitting there doing the bounce. But
that's what she said.
Yeah, yeah. I wish she had been, but. But, you know, the dealer room was sparse, but, you know, hey, what was great about it is that there were some great deals on the dealer room floor, and, you know, if there was something there for somebody to get, it was rather easy to get because there was nobody there really competing for it. You know, you had time to generally pass something up and think about it, you know. Ooh, I almost fell backwards. But
Grandma always said, "Don't lean in the chair. Don't lean back in the chair."
This computer chair that I'm sitting in, it actually does not have a backstop, so I can't just lean back in it like I normally would, or else it would continue on backwards.
Did you break it like I broke my chair?
No, it was broke before. It's my wife's, and
mine leans forward. It's not supposed to lean forward like this.
But
I will fall forward if I don't lean back.
That may make for good YouTube, man.
Yeah,
you might want to fall back during one of the podcasts.
Yeah, I don't know. I'd probably kill myself because there's like, well, here's something cool. A lot of people might not see an actual NES in the box. It's still in here. This is my NES from my childhood.
Does it work?
Wow.
Yes, it still works, and I still have the original receipt in this sucker.
And I've got still work?
Yeah. And I've got a N64 over here the same way, and a
Durin?
Super NES. Yes.
I'm sorry.
I'm going to have to come murder you now.
I have my original Game Boy. It still works.
And I have a GameCube and a bunch of games up for sale, but I've had no takers on it. But
hey, you know what the funny thing is, Durin? He's the one, Mike's making all those comments, but, you know, he probably wasn't even alive when that came out, so, you know, it's not a big deal.
I purchased it in 1989, so, yeah.
I was born in 88.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
So wow. You were small enough to fit in the box when he bought it. Yeah.
You know, I totally didn't do my ouch my wallet. We got talking about everything else. Yeah.
New NES system, folks.
Yeah. Well, I was talking about buying things, and I'm like, I did. We did you guys, but I totally forgot about myself.
Aside from being a Transformers enthusiast, I'm a video game enthusiast.
Yeah. We'll kind of split up the SagaCon segment and the Beast Wars segment, and I'll throw my ouch my wallet in there.
We're gonna talk NES.
Yeah. But yeah, last year's show, while the attendance was actually quite small, I had a great time. And there is no reason why people this year could not have a great time, especially, you know, the pre-registrants are up, huge dealer room, and great guests. I mean, Arlene Bannis, I mean, she was kind of an ancillary character, you know, in Carly, to be honest, but I kind of want to meet her. She was in the G1 cartoon. I haven't seen her.
In 1967, she was Miss Chicago.
Really?
Yes.
So she was quite the looker when she was younger, too.
Yeah, and I've talked to several people, and I guess she still looks very, very attractive at 67 years old.
I know her IMDb photo is not bad. I mean, you know, for an older woman.
She's 67.
So. Yeah. She's a cougar.
You got one of those at your house, don't you?
She's a year older than me. Yeah. But, yeah. And then of course, Buster Jones. I mean, Blaster. I always loved Blaster from the original cartoon, so I'm really jazzed. I'm really jazzed to see him.
You know, he actually did Jazz's voice when Scatman Crothers was not able to do it.
Really?
Yeah, he was telling me that today. Sure was. Sure did. He there was a couple episodes where he actually did Jazz's voice.
That's awesome. He doesn't happen to remember which episodes those were, was he?
No.
Oh.
No.
It was 30 years ago. Can't expect him to, but.
Now, he remembers quite a bit about the Transformer stuff, and I'm anxious to talk to him in person. I've had several conversations with him, obviously, over the phone, just doing business. Mm-hmm. But he's a very interesting individual. I have never talked in the time I've been doing this, in the 4 years I've been doing this, the two guests I have this year, I have never talked to nicer guests, ever. I mean, these two that we have coming are just awesome. So I think they're really going to be great for the fans. And Duren, you get to sit next to them.
Yeah, I'm really looking forward to having them on the show. You know, and listeners that are listening to this show, in about a week, we're going to have Arlene Bannis and Buster Jones and a few other people on the show. Of course, Chad, we'll have you on the show again. But if you have
they
time.
They may not want me on here after this week, so might want to get some listener feedback.
We'll love to have you on, but the show last year, in a lot of ways, and I know we mentioned this on a previous episode, but I mean, quite frankly, it was disappointing in a lot of ways, but in a lot of ways, it was not, and it was totally worth the trip. I do not regret going last year, and I had so much fun that I am wanting to go this year. You know, so.
The nice thing about the amount of people we had last year is it made the show very personable.
Yes.
You got a lot of one-on-one time with everybody, and everyone talked to one another. You didn't see anybody come in and just, like, hang out by themselves and leave.
Mm-hmm.
You know, everybody talked to everybody.
I thought it was really awesome. I actually was introduced Scott McNeil to Dr. Smoove, or Dr. Smoove's videos on my phone.
Nice.
Yeah, Scott McNeil was literally standing there with my phone in his hand, sitting there watching the Rude Awakening of Optimus Prime, laughing his ass off. It was just.
I actually have been looking at. Talking to those guys. I've talked to Randall, NG.
Mm-hmm.
You might know him from the Transformers video done to that dance, that Korean dance song or whatever.
Yeah, the Gangnam
that
style.
That has like 3 million hits or whatever. Yeah. But I've talked to him a couple times. I'm actually looking at maybe having him as a guest at some point. Him and Dr. Smoove. And having them do a panel on what they do, because they have a production company of some kind together, or they produce stuff together. So
this year, you mentioned earlier that you moved to the Cincinnati area. You want to tell us a little bit about the plans for this year? And you've mentioned some of the guests, but, you know, tell us more about the convention this year and the move.
Okay, well, the move was incited by obviously low attendance for more or less being in my mom's basement. So Scott McNeil put it last year so eloquently.
How
he put it. He goes, "I heard you're having your convention in your mom's basement," and I took him, you know, right there at this where we had it last year during.
Yeah.
You know the door that's at the stage?
Yes.
That was to the side of the stage. If you open that door and you look down the stairs, the basement underneath the school was right underneath the gym. I was like, yeah, Scott, you're – I go – we walked in there. I go, Scott, yeah, we're having it right down here, buddy, right down here. He was like, yeah, I'm not going down there. So, but this year, we're having it at the Hilton, Cincinnati Airport. It's a very nice hotel. They have a very nice restaurant inside. Very, very hospitable people I've been dealing with. So, you know, we had a pretty good deal on the hotel rooms, $99 a night. That ended on October 4th, unfortunately. Per them, not per me. We've got... Let me pull up something real quick, and I will look how many dealers we actually have.
While he's doing that, I want to remind listeners to the podcast, if you have any questions or comments, you can tweet them at TFYLP on Twitter, or you can mention them in the comments section on the YouTube video. We're monitoring that, so if you want to ask any questions or have any comments, feel free to do so. Especially if you're listening live, you can ask Chad here on the podcast live, and he can answer your questions. If you are listening to the downloaded version of this, you can email us at podcast@tfylp.net, or you can post it to our Facebook group and. Chad actually is able to see the questions on there and is able to answer the questions directly as well.
We have 22 dealers, which are 10 by 20 booths. We have a 10 by 40 booth, a 10 by 30 booth, four or five 10 by 10s, and a ton of tables. So... we've got
22 dealers. That's like double what last year's was.
Yeah, it's double. I will mention the people. We have Dungeon Dwellers Comics, who's coming. Pappy's Collectibles. Mega Toy Fan, TF Marketplace. This Ick Stack from the TFW boards.
I believe that's Alpha Prime, isn't it? No, that's not Alpha Prime.
No, it's Ick Stack.
Okay, yeah, I know Ick Stack.
Mike Boyle, he's been a dealer every year. I have a couple of new dealers. Angel Vargas is going to be a dealer. Of course, Captured Prey. I wanted to mention them last, but I'm going to have to mention them now. I've got one surprise dealer. That's my booths. I have a guy named Letus Reed as well. But I have one surprise dealer that I'm not going to mention, and you will just have to come and see who it is.
Is it who you mentioned to me the other night?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
That is a big name too. So yeah.
Yes, a very big name, very well known.
I would say.
he's
somewhat controversial, but
yes, he's bringing he's going to have a 10 by 20 booth, and a lot of his space, or part of his space, is going to be a display of. Some of his personal collection. And we're not talking just the run-of-the-mill stuff. We're talking some of the very rare, one-of-a-kind prototypes kind of stuff. But I'm not going to mention his name. So he's bringing some friends with him. There's another guy that was on Toy Hunters that is coming with him that is also going to be a dealer. And I'm not going to mention his name because I was asked not to. So, but we've got some big, I really feel, other than not having the two biggest toy companies, you know, with BBTS and TF Source, I'd say I do pretty good with who I bring to the table.
Well, if you have a really good turnout this year, who's to say that they won't, you know, come next year, or at least, you know, one of them might come next year.
Yeah, and I've talked to both of them, and they're not beyond it, but it's just not financially doable for them currently.
Yeah. Well, BBTS is
huge.
You know, well, they're huge, but it's not just the fact that they're huge, but they're actually relatively close. They could actually come to the convention because we're about 6.5 hours from where they are.
TF Source is the same way, man. They're both.
No, oh, that's right. Yeah.
Located 20 minutes from one another.
Yeah.
Both located in the same city almost.
Hmm.
So
I thought TF Source was on the East Coast.
No, he's over there with TF or BBTS.
Hmm.
Pretty sure that's what I read. I could be wrong. Maybe I ought to Google it before I start saying stuff. But so let's get into some of the cool stuff that we're gonna have this year. This is an empty swag bag to the first 100 pre-registrants that come through the door. Or, well, all the pre-registrants will get it, and whatever's left to get to 100, and I'm not saying if there will be any left or not, so you'll have to come and find out. You'll get one of these, but it's limited to 100. Now, it does have some cool stuff in it. I've got flyers in here so far, all from Kentucky and a couple different dealers. Mega Toy Fan is going to put a G1 toy in every one of the bags.
I kind of have some wonder. I've had a look through some top of his spins. Stuff. Yeah, I'm kind of wondering if it's Top Spin or Twin Twist. Because the last time was last year at Slagacon, he literally had a giant bag of Top Spin and Twin Twists.
He said that's not it. He told me what he's giving. That's not it. I can guarantee you it's not those two. He has a huge selection of toys.
Yes, he does.
He does not bring everything to our show. This year he's bringing more, but he's still not bringing everything. I know he has a 40x40 space that he has filled with stuff. But that's not the only thing we got, you know, this year. We got the little exclusives. Here's the box. City Protection Commander. It's sponsored by Mega Toy Fan. Just give them a little shout out. But the city, I'm going to read the back of this real quick. The City Protection Commander is the leader of all city protection drones, as well as the Stealth Force Protection Soldiers. He's a strong leader, but lacks in personality due to issues that haunt him from his past. Kind of following along the same storyline as what it looks like. But here is one of the City Protection Commanders.
Eichenhaus.
So, a size comparison. I will do a size comparison for you. Let's see. Here's an FOC Jazz. And here is the City Protection Commander.
Oh, pretty good size.
So it's pretty good size. It's actually bigger than the Creon Devastator. It's actually a little bit taller than that. So it kind of goes along with the TF storyline and the sizes that were actually in the cartoons, or relatively close. Now, I did mention two others. I mentioned the City Protection Drone, and I don't know if I can get a good close-up of his face, but you notice he has no face.
Uh-huh.
It's because he's a drone. I decided to go with just a drone with no face. On this, I'm trying to get a good centered picture, and I have to go the opposite direction, I noticed. But yeah, that is that. And then there's a total between those two. There's a total of 50 figures that we're selling. Basically 25 and 25, well, so to speak. But I also mentioned the stealth protection, or the stealth force protection soldier. I can never remember that name, so I have to look at it.
This is the first time we're seeing it, too.
First time that this has been seen. This is a blind. These are set up as blind figures, as you could tell from the box that I showed you just a minute ago. So every box, and I'm going to show this just for everybody so they can see it. Every box has a number on it, and it's 1 through 25. Well, there's 22 City Protection Commanders. There's 22 City Protection Drones. And there's 6 of these. So that equals 50. Well, in this box, you can't tell what's in it. And it's going to have a sleeve on it. It's either going to say City Protection Commander or City Protection Drone. But in the box, you'll notice this one's a City Protection Commander. But 3 lucky people for each one of these is actually going to be a City Protection, or a City or Stealth Force Protection Soldier, which is an Omegatron homage, which is pre-G1. So that's pretty much the exclusive.
Basically, what you're saying is that it's a take on the Diaclone version of Omega Supreme.
Yes, sir. It sure is. It is a take on that. I copied the colors as best I could without, in the design, without really, you know, messing up or making it look exactly the same. So that was my goal. I have those. I'm trying to think if I have anything else. I do have another set that's going to be at the Mega Toy Fan booth. And I guess, Duren, I'm going to go ahead and let you guys see this. So,
well, it's up to you. We're not twisting your arm.
No, but I figured you'd mention it. And so, you know, you got these big protection bots that are, you know, like Omega Supreme. Let me fix this guy to where he's the right way to show off. You got like Omega Supreme, Omega Sentinel, and Omegatron. And then we're at the Mega Toy Fan booth. We are going to have, well, we're going to have a broken bot. No, that ain't it.
You broke it already.
I broke it. I feel like the guy from Tommy Boy. Tommy, what we need? And I, you know, he's like, and acting like he's smashing the roll or whatever. But we're going to have another exclusive over there. By the way, all these do transform. The Omega, or the City Protection commanders and bots and drones and Omegatrons, you have to take them apart, but they do transform. They actually make a little base, a little tank, and a little rocket. So, and I may show that off a little bit later. But the ones that are going to be at the Mega Toy Fan booth are the Black Zarek-esque Black Zarek-esque, we call him Dark Czar, figure. And I will do a size comparison between these and the other ones if his legs don't fall off. I'm having technical difficulties here, Duren. But this is Dark Czar.
Very nice.
Falling over.
Basically, it's a... for those who are listening on the downloadable version, it is a Creo-like version of Black Zarek.
But since I'm in such a good mood, and I'm going to give you guys the drop on everybody, we are going to show you the transformed version of the Black Zarek, Black Dark Czar toy. Without breaking it, hopefully.
You know, I think we've lost the same Galvatron on here.
What's that?
We've lost the same Galvatron completely on here.
Yeah, I noticed that, man. What's
He was driving, but maybe
he rage quit.
Signal lost. Yeah,
he rage quit. Popo, yeah. Maybe the Popo got the better of him this time.
No podcasting and driving.
No podcasting and driving. That's right. I would have been doing that tonight had it not worked out the way it did.
Mm-hmm.
Podcasting and driving. But without further ado, here is the Scorpion version. I don't know.
It looks really good. I can see good on my screen.
Can you see that pretty well, Mike?
Yeah.
Looks like the tail has good articulation in the pinchers. Do the pinchers open and close?
Yes. This on the tail they do not, but on the hands, yes, they all move. All three move. So now this as well has a blind, two blind figures. There's a total of 10 of them. And there's two blind exclusives, and they are going to look. This is a call. We call this a. I can't remember what we call this. actually, my dad came up with the name, and it's a really awesome name. Like Scorpsidian is the name of it. I liked it, so I stuck with it. But here, and this, if you'll notice, the pinchers are different and everything, but here is our take on Scorpsidian.
Very nice.
Let me use my other hand. That hand shakes. So
that's a Creo. It looks like a Creo version of G1 Scorponok.
Yeah, and I will do a size comparison for you to show you the size difference between this and the City Protection Commander or the Omega Supreme-esque Creon. exclusive.
So it looks like it's about a full head taller.
Yeah. So this is the Omega Supreme is a full head, or probably about half a head taller than the Creon Devastator combiner. And then you've seen how tall these were. So those are all the exclusives we're going to have at the show this year, other than the one you posted. I noticed you got a hold of one of my pictures this week somehow.
Oh, yes. And,
posted it on your website. Cheater.
Let me pull it up here. If I can do a little screen share here.
He's went black, folks.
On the internet at one time, and I suspect my wife is upstairs watching Hulu right now. So it's a miracle. Let me for everyone that's watching live and or listening to the podcast, I'm going to edit this part out because, this has just been a night of nothing but.
You saw my post on the Facebook page. It said, technical glitches merge for the kill. And we started 30 minutes late because we couldn't get around a few technical glitches.
And let's see here. I've tweeted that. let me go to TFYLP.
You're going to love it. I told him that his Scorponok killed the stream.
Yeah. I'm going to go on here.
Hey, don't do that again, Dern.
I'm not going to.
I can probably pull it up and share.
Yeah, the thing is if I drop out, the whole call drops out because I'm the one that's...
Yeah, started. I know. Mike and I were having a good conversation. I was getting ready to show him some pretty neat stuff, but you came back and I couldn't show him. So.
Gosh. Ruined all my fun. And I'm going to go crazy when I get my
job. I'm posting to the main page here, so let's see here.
My Creo shelf is going to explode when I start making money. Like, right now I have 8 micro changers, the blind packs, and then I have the 4 first wave combiners. It's like, my plan is all of them.
Plan 9 from outer space.
Hey, Mike, you want to... You don't want to hear how many Creos and Creons and different things I had to buy to complete this project. So
I'm sure it's about.
I got about 400 extra Creon parts, just legs. I've got dismembered robots in a box, just like laying around, begging for me to take them out and do something with them.
Here, kids, have some robot legs.
Legs, arms. Usually they're missing the chest pieces, and some of them are missing their heads, so they're walking around running into stuff. I mean, it's kind of weird, but, you know. Hey.
Let's see here. Post. Oh, cannot connect. Well, whatever. Hopefully I've got everything back up and running here so we can continue. But again, we were getting ready to show the lithograph preview for SlaggerCon until my connection completely went kaput and the whole broadcast dropped, and we do apologize for that. That's actually a first time we've ever had that happen here on TFYLP since we've been doing a live broadcast. We've had some issues actually getting the broadcast going, but once we actually got it going, we've never had it just drop on us. So that's actually a first. So, yay, I guess.
I'm glad I can be here for that, Durin.
Yeah. But, hey, such is technology, and that's how it goes. At least the people who download this won't have to... put up with the 10 to 15 minutes of silence, me frantically working to try to get the thing going here. But now that we are going, we need to continue here. I think the best way to do it to help people see what we're talking about, you can go to the front page of tftalk.net and pull it up. It should be on the front page. You can view the lithograph there, or the preview image of it. This artwork is actually done by a former guest of TFYLP, Candace Centora.
And SlagaCon.
Yes. She was actually at the second ever SlagaCon with Gary Chalk, was she not?
Yes, she was.
So a big shout out to Candace.
The Gary Chalk episode, it was good.
Yes.
Go back and listen to it.
Yes, it is available in the Legacy Podcast area, so you can go on to tftalk.net and check out that episode. Plug.
I've got it. I've got it up. Dern, if you want me to.
Okay.
I'm not sure exactly what I'm doing, but
you hit screen share on the side.
And just have it up.
And then you'll have to choose you'll choose the window that it's in.
Okay.
And it should pop up.
That's what she said.
Well, yeah, it's not wanting to do. Why is it not?
Don't you just love technology?
It's not wanting. I mean, I've got it pulled up. It's just not showing me the. It says select a window to show, and it's not showing me the window.
That's odd.
There we go. I got it.
There we go. Yes. Yes, Mike.
How's that?
Well, it's there. We go.
Oh,
pretty nice. It's big. Oh, that's wow! Wow, that's big. That's what she said. Looks like we got.
That's actually 11. It's 11x17 lithograph. So everybody who gets a swag bag gets one of those for free.
Without all the words over top of it, I put that on there so nobody get a bright idea to just print it out and do their own.
Yeah, good luck with that because that's low resolution.
Yeah. But the listeners that are listening on the downloadable version of the podcast here, the image is of Blaster, G1 Blaster, and Carly. They're standing in a desert. Blaster is holding three cassette tapes in cassette form. It looks like he's got Grand Slam, Steel Jaw, and looks like Rewind in his hand in cassette form. Then you have Rain Dance flying around him with the contrail going around Blaster, and you have Ramhorn kind of running around the front of Carly, and Eject is running away from Blaster. I guess he thought Blaster farted or something other. He's kind of running away.
Well, that's what he thought the contrail was.
Yeah. it is really, really nice. And I think Candace should be commended on her excellent work there. See here. What else we got going at the con here?
I'm not sure. You'd think I organized this thing or something.
Well, I think this technical thing here where the episode got split in two kind of threw everything all helter-skelter here.
Let's see. I've covered dealers. The only thing I haven't covered is the Frenzy Rumble. Well, I haven't covered two things, and I'll save the best for last, or three things. The voice actors, you definitely want to see their panel on Saturday and Sunday because it's two different sets of voice actors. The voice actors on Saturday are Transformer voice actors, and they're going to go through some of their memories of doing the show and what it was like in the room with all the other voice actors. And so it's not going to be as long as Scott's and John's, just due to who the guests are. But I think the quality will be there with them just as much as anyone that we've ever had. Oh, yeah. And then Daniel and John having their own little sci-fi horror thing on Sunday. I'm interested to see what Daniel Ross has to say when I just let him loose on the crowd. So, because that's what I did. I gave him free rein. I told him, this is all about you, buddy. You can do whatever you want.
Now, Daniel Ross, he was the voice of Starscream, movie Starscream in the first video game, was he not?
Yes, he is. Yes. Hey, there's my co-owner. She just peeked her head in. They can't see you. You're not coming in. She's not coming in. She's not camera ready.
Not camera ready.
So,
her hand made an appearance on TFYLP.
But so I'm kind of curious what Daniel Ross is going to bring up since I'm allowing him free reign, so to speak. So I covered that. Let's talk about the customizing class taught by Frenzy Rumble. Mike, can you possibly look up, I think it's on your page, isn't it? Did you share Frenzy Rumble's exclusive for this year?
I don't remember. Let me look back. Let me search it. No, the we got the lithograph. Well, it's not showing my older posts on there too, for some reason. I might not have actually tagged it whenever I posted it.
Okay, let me close this window. Let me see if I can do this screen share thing. Did it come up?
I've got a black screen. Oh, yes. There we go. There we go. Oh, yes.
Oh, yeah. I remember seeing that.
That's the customizing class figure.
That is a clever use of that mold.
LED lights.
Mike, if you want to kind of describe it to the listeners on the downloadable.
So it's slag or slug, but it's slag. Out of Beast Hunter's Bulkhead, the deluxe. And it looks... Skype. It looks really good. It's definitely slag, without a doubt.
Yeah, it's in the...
Is it better use of that mold than Bulkhead?
Yeah, in the vehicle form, it's got like a gray, mainly a gray body with a golden hood and some gold accents on the fenders. Then you got a red grill, and then in robot form, he's got that hulking look like Bulkhead had, and slag, and then he's got the wings that come out like the sides of the dinosaur did on the Generation 1 version. Then he's got like a red chest, gray legs, gray arms, black fists, black head. Yeah, it's really, really awesome looking. And I have to admit, it's a really good choice for that mold.
I like how Mike molded the horn that goes on the hood.
Yes.
So that third horn, because the other two are part of the mold, are part of the Bulkhead mold. But the third one is not, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, I don't think it's there.
It's like, so it's kind of like a pre-Cybertronian or pre-Earth version of Slag.
Yes.
I guess.
So I'm anxious to, I will have mine as soon as Frenzy Rumble shows up to the show, because he already made mine for me, so I can display it at the show. But I'm looking forward to that class. And then we've got two other things. We've got I keep remembering stuff as I'm talking. We've got a charity auction for, and I am putting up the last piece of my original collection that I sold off. This is the only piece I kept, and I'm selling off, or I'm donating to charity this last thing that I've got. It's Nemesis Prime, the classics Nemesis Prime, with the Fans Project trailer, with the two Perfect Effect guns that go in the sides. I don't know if I can't remember what their names are. PEO1 and PEO2, I believe, is their numbers.
Okay, yeah, they kind of look like the eject and rewind, only they're like in black colors.
Yeah, and one has the red. One's the first edition, and one's the second edition. I waited and got the second release so I could have different colors on the ends of the guns. So I've got a yellow on one side and a red gun, a red end of the gun on the other side. I would show it to you, but it's in that closet that's behind me, and if you can see back there, that's kind of a mess. I really don't want to step back there. I'm afraid for my life, actually.
That's why I have a wall here of Transformer boxes.
I got some laundry right there.
So let's see. We've talked about that. What we are giving our money to, what we are giving the charity money to, is the Purple Heart Foundation. They help people who have received a Purple Heart and have fallen on hard times. So, you know, they help them out. A really good cause, and I don't know if you know this, but one of the owners of Brett, one of the owners, or Megamus, as everybody knows him, is a Purple Heart recipient. So it's something that's near and dear to him, and he talked to me about it, and I was like, man, that really sounds awesome, because I'm all about soldiers and police officers. My dad was a police officer for 20 years. So I'm, you know, it's something near and dear to my heart. And so we're trying to help those people out. And I hope that a lot of people donate something so we can, you know, give a pretty good chunk of money to the Purple Heart Foundation.
That's really awesome. I just tweeted that on the Twitter. That is really awesome. I like that idea. That's I know Brett is a police officer himself. So
in the fine state of Kentucky.
Yes. So I know that will mean a lot to him as well.
The last thing, I saved the best for last. Well, we'll say the best for last. And it's too bad your two cosplayers are not here to actually talk to us about this and get all excited. But
yeah, Natsume Ryu, she's on the road, and I believe Amber is actually, or Mirai Baby, she's actually working tonight. So,
man, I hate work. I'm glad I actually ended up with it off, because otherwise I'd be driving and doing this. But we're having a cosplay contest, and we're giving out some pretty good prizes, I think, you know, at least from the reactions I've gotten from people. Seems like a $250 first prize, a $150 second prize, and a $100 third prize.
That's fantastic. Good. I know we mentioned that on an earlier podcast, and both Natsume and Mirai Baby were really excited about that. They actually regret the fact that they can't be at the con You know, Amber mainly because of the distance, because she lives in San Diego, and Natsume because she's got work to do with. So again,
yeah,
work
getting in the way. She can go to BotCon and they can put her on the cover of a magazine or something.
Yeah. Yeah. So. But still, that's the money prize. I think, as far as you know, for a cosplayer, from what I understand, for a cosplayer, a cash prize is a lot more more coveted than, say, a prize on than a cover of a magazine, because cosplayers, part of the biggest thing for them is that there's a lot of cost that goes into making the outfits, and right. to be able to recoup some of that cost by winning a contest with it, or just winning money for a period, makes it worthwhile for them. So a cash prize is actually better than a magazine cover, from what I've understood.
Now, I know Rosemary Ward, not to throw around names, but I know she's coming to the show. And she has expressed interest in being in the cosplay contest. And she said that she is going to bring one of her Transformer costumes that she has made from a few years ago, but yeah, it's can't remember if she said it was Wheeljack or Soundwave.
Well, we do need to wrap up. I know we tried to wrap up earlier, but yeah.
But Beast Wars
is really cool. Beast Wars is really cool, and there's a lot to talk about, and I'm sure we'll talk a lot more about it this coming week. Watch our Twitter feed and our Facebook page for a date and time. It'll probably be early next week as opposed to late, because later next week I'm going to have some prep work to do for SlagaCon. But for Insane Galvatron, who missed out on us earlier in the podcast, and Chad Williams from SlagaCon, we thank him again for joining us. And you, Sideburn, we'll see you next time on TFYLP. This is Weird Wolf signing off. Good night, everyone.
See you, everybody.
Chad Williams, a father, a son, a husband, and a friend. I first had the privilege of meeting Chad about 6 years ago or so, when I was looking on the website TFW 2005. I ran across a user named TransJazz, who was posting about this new convention he was throwing together called SlagaCon. And being that I was living not too far away, I figure I might be able to lend some assistance with some friends of mine and help him to get the show off to a pretty good start, you know, help him with setup and things. And I have to say our friendship only blossomed from there. I was with Chad at all four SlagaCon conventions, 2010 through 2013, and helped him out each of those years, and had many great experiences with him. He's always just the kindest, most genuine person you'd ever meet. In almost everything that he did, he went out of his way to make sure that those he cared about were taken care of, and that the fans and guests were his absolute priority in any of these shows. And over the years, I've gotten to know Chad a little bit better, and I've seen just how much of a caring soul Chad was. And it's really, honestly, pretty hard realizing that he's left us. But I like to think that I'm a pretty lucky guy, because I had the chance to know Chad Williams in the short time that I did. I mean, just for little things, you know, like, you know, setting up the convention, getting Gary Chalk a cup of coffee at his request, being his designated driver, because he had just worn himself out so much one year that he just, he could not safely drive. I mean, he was that determined. His heart was in it that much, in caring for others and in the service of what he was trying to do for others. And my heart goes out to all of you, Charles, Tina, Kristen, Camden, Miles. I know this has to be especially hard on all of you. I can only think back to when I lost my own father in 2007 and what I had to go through. So believe me when I say I understand just how rough it can be. And just do me a favor. It's something that I always do anytime I think of my father, and it's something I want you all to do too when you think of Chad. Is I want you to smile. In anything that Chad did, the time that I knew him, it was his goal to see that the people that he was serving were happy and that they had a smile on their face. That's what he wanted. And I think that's what he got. So believe me when I say I am especially thankful that I was lucky enough to have the chance to know Chad Williams.